day of fall. So the format for today will follow a similar format to previous information sessions. So we'll start with an update on the epidemiology or the numbers of COVID-19 across the region. Next, we'll have some updates around vaccinations, and then finally, a few updates just around general kind of public health measures related to COVID-19. So starting off with an update related to the epidemiology or numbers of COVID-19 across HKPR jurisdiction. So as of today, we're at a total of 2,409 confirmed cases of COVID-19 having been identified since the start of the pandemic across HKPR jurisdiction. We currently have 27 active cases, 4 in the county of Haliburton, 11 in the city of Kawartha Lakes, and 12 in Northumberland. There are currently 116 high-risk contacts that are being followed and supported by the health unit. And I did want to flag that this is actually a double of the number of high-risk contacts that I reported last week. One of the things that we have identified over the last several weeks is the significant increase in the number of high-risk contacts being identified. This just means that with every case that has been identified, where before they might list 3 or 4 individuals that would be high-risk contacts, now we're seeing 10, 15, 20 individuals identified as high-risk contacts. This is just a reflection of ongoing social gathering, which is currently permitted under the regulations, but still poses a risk for the spread of COVID-19 and something that we're seeing reflected in the number of high-risk contacts being identified. We continue to have 2 outbreaks. One is associated with the Central East Correctional Center in the city of Kawartha Lakes. That outbreak still stands at 18 cases, all among the inmate population. We have confirmed that the Delta variant is responsible for that outbreak, which is as suspected. The other outbreak that was reported last week was from a private social gathering in the county of Northumberland in Brighton. And there's currently 7 cases associated with that outbreak. Not all of those cases, however, are in HKPR jurisdiction. Some are in other public health unit jurisdictions. Our 7-day rolling incidence rate today is 11.1 cases per 100,000 population. The rate has been creeping up a little bit. We spent several days at a 7-day rolling incidence rate of around 16 cases per 100,000. And our 7-day test positivity rate as of last week was 2.2%, which is higher than what we have seen for the last couple of months since the third wave. I think that when we look at the provincial numbers, I know I'm somewhat reassured that we are not seeing the steep climb in the number of new cases being identified provincially as compared to other provinces in Canada. That being said, I think that there's a number of unknowns and a number of variables that are going to influence the number of cases reported across Ontario in the upcoming weeks. So, for example, we're still waiting to see what the full impact is of return to school and whether or not we see more school cases or outbreaks. We're still waiting to see what the impact will be of people generally spending more time indoors. We know that it's the first day of fall and the weather is starting to cool off, although still warm for this time of year. But certainly as we get into the later fall months, people tend to spend more time inside. And so as the limits on gatherings is not changing, we do anticipate that there will be an increase in spread still throughout the fall. A couple of comments just on the characteristics of cases that have been identified in the last 14 days. So there have been 61 new cases identified across HKPR jurisdiction in the last 14 days. 31% of those cases were among the age group of 20 to 29, and 19.7% were among the age group of 30 to 39. So very consistent with previous sessions that we've had, predominantly cases are among the younger adult population. In terms of source of transmission, 39.3% have no identifiable source of exposure or transmission. 23% were household contacts, 19.7% considered to be close contacts, and then 14.8% associated with an outbreak. We have had one new hospital admission in the last 14 days. We went for several weeks, really, with no new hospital admissions, but we have had one among an HKPR District Health Unit resident in the last 14 days. I'll share some updated statistics about the proportion of cases that are vaccinated. So of the 249 cases that have been confirmed in HKPR jurisdiction since July 1st, 69.1% of those cases were unvaccinated or there was no record of vaccination. So zero doses of COVID-19 vaccine or no record. And this is equivalent to 172 cases of COVID-19. Among 249 cases confirmed, 18.1% were partially vaccinated, so only received one dose, or they were considered to be not fully protected yet. It had not been 14 days since their second dose of vaccine. And then 12.9% were fully vaccinated. So this is consistent with what we see across the province, with the majority of cases, new cases identified to have COVID-19 among individuals that are either not vaccinated, followed by partially vaccinated or not fully protected yet. And to me, this just speaks to the protective effect of COVID-19 vaccination and that it is influencing influencing where we are seeing infection of COVID-19, with it now predominantly being among individuals not vaccinated. I'll move now to an update around COVID-19 vaccination. So as of September 20th, Monday of this week, when we updated our dashboard, among the population that is age 12 and over, 83.8% have received one dose of vaccine and 78.8% have received two doses of vaccine. So week to week, we're seeing an increase in coverage of approximately 1%, at most 2% increase per week. So where before we used to see maybe a 10% jump in vaccination coverage from week to week, it's certainly a much slower incremental increase in coverage, but it's still increasing. And we're still seeing an increase in the number of people attending to get their first dose of vaccine, which I think we're really quite pleased and thank everyone for continuing to be aware and committed to helping protect everyone in the community. The age cohort that has the lowest vaccination coverage rate is still the young adult population of 18 to 29-year-olds, with 72.7% having received one dose of vaccine and 66.3% having received two doses of vaccine. Among the population that is age 60 and over, we are currently at 89.7% having received one dose of vaccine. So just shy of 90%, very, very close. And I imagine that by next week, we will hit that 90% mark, having received one dose of COVID-19 vaccine among the population that is age 60 and over. I did want to highlight today one population in particular that we've noted to have a lower coverage rate than what we really would like to see, and that I think is important for health and wellness of the community. So among women that are pregnant across HKPR District Health Unit jurisdiction, only 58.5% of pregnant women have received their first dose of vaccine, and only 47.3% have received two doses of COVID-19 vaccine. So these numbers are consistent with other health units across the province, and so provincially seeing a lower coverage rate of COVID-19 vaccination across the population that is pregnant. I think there's a number of reasons behind this. I think certainly pregnancy is often a period of heightened anxiety and a period where, you know, women and their family and the communities are more cautious often about medications or vaccines and really more cautious about protecting their health overall. There has been misinformation in various social media sites and feeds related to the impact of COVID-19 vaccine among pregnant women. All of the data that we have to date has indicated there is no risk to increase in harmful effects from COVID-19 vaccine on pregnant women or on the unborn baby. In fact, what we know with data recently released by the Ontario Science Advisory Table is that if a woman that's pregnant does get COVID-19 infection, they are at higher risk of more severe disease associated with that. And we have heard of reports of ICU admissions among pregnant women in other jurisdictions that currently have a high number of cases being reported. So I wanted to flag that and to share that and encourage women that are currently pregnant or thinking about becoming pregnant, that if you have concerns, to speak to your healthcare provider. Ask your questions and I think be receptive to the information that we have that's available. We know that COVID-19 vaccine is safe and effective, and I really would encourage pregnant women to connect with their care provider to discuss further. In terms of how to access COVID-19 vaccine, so still the same main routes that we've discussed previously. So our website lists all of the locations, dates, and times for COVID-19 vaccination clinics across all three areas in HKPR jurisdiction. For any clinic, walk-ins are welcome, and any dose, first or second dose, people are welcome to come. Both mRNA vaccines are available at all of our clinics. And so we really do just welcome anyone that has yet to receive their first dose or their second dose. We're continuing with a more targeted strategy of mobile and pop-up clinics in areas that either by geography have been identified to have a lower coverage rate or by other features such as individuals, for example, that might be at higher risk due to other conditions. We're also continuing with school-based clinics. So we work with three school boards across all of HKPR jurisdiction. With our school board partner in the northern part of HKPR jurisdiction, so both Haliburton County and City of Kawartha Lakes, we've been working with the Trillium Lakelands District School Board. We have clinics that are being hosted at area high schools. At those high schools, there is a clinic that is during school hours that is hosted for students and staff. And then there's another clinic that is hosted after school hours for students, staff, families, and community members, and encouraging especially those youth that might attend elementary schools but are eligible for vaccine to attend. For Northumberland County, we work with two other school boards, and these clinics are also located at high schools, but they are after school hours only. So they're held late afternoon to early evening, open to students, staff, families, and the general community members. We are seeing continued uptake or continued interest in people coming for their vaccination. I think we would like to see higher numbers, especially among youth, as we're also seeing how youth in particular are impacted when there is a case of COVID-19 at school. We have had, since school started about, I guess, 2.5 weeks ago now, we have had two cases that have been that are in school-aged children, so one at a high school and one at an elementary school. The current guidance for case and contact management is that if a youth or a student is fully vaccinated and they don't have any symptoms for COVID-19, then they do not need to quarantine for 10 days. And once we have confirmed their vaccination status, they're able to attend class again. Because we know that vaccination coverage among schools and among youth does vary significantly, this does mean that there might be some classes where a high number of students might have to quarantine for the full 10 days, or there might be classes with a high number of students that are fully vaccinated and can return to class almost immediately. I would like to also continue to emphasize the availability of vaccines through area pharmacies, as well as through different primary care teams. So whether it's a family doctor, community health center, other family health team that might have COVID-19 vaccine available as well. Certainly, if people are concerned about potential side effects from COVID-19 vaccine, or have specific questions, you can speak with your either your primary care provider or somebody at the health unit. For individuals that have a history of allergic reactions, whether it's to vaccine or other things, we do take extra precautions and monitor people for a longer period of time at our clinics to ensure that they're not having a reaction. So we certainly have supports in place to help people that might be concerned about any immediate side effects of the vaccine. There have been no updated provincial announcements in the last week regarding which people are eligible to receive a third dose of vaccine. So we've previously discussed that there's two main groups of people that can get a third dose of vaccine. The first main group are people with a list of medical conditions that have resulted in their immune system being severely compromised or really not working as well. And those individuals are able to get a third dose of vaccine. And then the other group being residents of long-term care homes, high-risk retirement homes, and elder care lodges. Finally, there might be questions today, given the media reports around vaccination approval for 5 to 11-year-olds. So Pfizer will be putting in an application to the FDA in the United States for approval for use of the Pfizer COVID-19 vaccine among children and youth aged 5 to 11. It's anticipated that once it has received approval through the FDA, that the company will submit it then to Health Canada for approval. And then once approved by Health Canada, we could see rollout in Ontario. We're hoping by the end of this calendar year. We certainly don't know any specific dates at this point in time, but we're hopeful we will see it still within this calendar year. Those are my updates regarding vaccination. Just a couple of other general updates. So as you're all well aware, today the provincial regulations regarding providing proof of immunization to enter certain non-essential settings came into force. So the regulations associated with that came into force. Until October 22nd, individuals will have to demonstrate their receipt of vaccination until the electronic option or QR code becomes available in October. The ministry is continuing to communicate with health units to provide ways that we can ensure that people have access to their receipt, including people that don't have phones or access to a printer or access to internet. And so there's different initiatives or ways that people can print off their receipt so that they're able to demonstrate it or show it if there's a place that they would like to access. And then finally, there's been a bit of discussion about the media reports of approval of Pfizer vaccine, Moderna vaccine, and AstraZeneca vaccine by Health Canada. So when these vaccines were first introduced in Canada, because it was a public health emergency, the federal health minister issued an interim order for the vaccine to be authorized, still undergoing all of the same scrutiny that they would undergo by Health Canada, and they did undergo, but at a slightly faster timeline, recognizing that there was an emergency and there was an imminent risk to public health. So up until last week, those three vaccines had been authorized under an interim order of federal legislation. So that still means that they were authorized. They were just authorized under the interim order. They're now all also authorized under the full Food and Drug Act and Food and Drug Regulations federally. What this really means for all of us right now is that people have started calling them a new name, and I don't know how they decided on the names. I guess the companies decided on the names, but there are new names for each of those three vaccines. Although I anticipate that for some time yet, we're likely to still refer to them as the Pfizer, Moderna, and AstraZeneca vaccines. But I did want to clarify and emphasize that they were authorized for use before, and what this means is that they're now authorized under the full regulations and act at a federal level. So I'm going to pause there just to make sure we have lots of time for questions. I'm sure there's things that I haven't mentioned that people are wondering about. So thank you again for joining, and look forward to your questions.
Great. Thanks, Dr. Bocking. Lots of good information there. And I see one hand up already, and that is from Dan. So Dan, do you want to go ahead?
Perfect. Thanks so much, Andrea and Dr. Bocking, as always. First off, I'm just following up on a question Mark asked last week, I guess, regarding vaccination requirement for health unit staff. I guess any updates on that?
Yes, sorry, you're going to have to bear with me. I just have a guest in the room. The board for Haliburton, Kawartha, Pine Ridge District Health Unit did approve our immunization requirement policy, which includes the requirement for all staff, volunteers, and students to be fully immunized against COVID-19 and provide to the employer proof of immunization. We have announced the associated procedure to go with that, with full enforcement by November 1st, which is consistent with some of our area hospitals that staff are required to provide proof of immunization by.
Okay, great. Yeah, and you mentioned about some fact that some pregnant women are still among some of the less vaccinated, I guess. What kind of strategies, I guess, can the health unit take to reach this demographic?
Yeah, thanks, Dan. We have connected with area hospitals that have maternal child programs. So this would include any of the physicians or nurse practitioners, midwives that support women through birth at these locations, to ensure that all of these trusted providers have the information they need to support their clients in accessing vaccines, and that they have the information they need to be able to answer questions associated with it. We've also added it, or not looking at adding it to any of our prenatal education courses that are offered online. We've reached out through our Healthy Babies, Healthy Children program, which provides supports both before birth and then after birth to pregnant women and their families to ensure that women have the opportunity to ask any questions about the vaccination. So a number of strategies. I don't think there's one strategy that will answer it, but I think the key is that if women have a concern, that they approach kind of their trusted care provider to ask some of those questions and receive accurate information.
Great, thanks.
Okay, great. Thanks, Dan. I see now that Sarah has her hand up. And Sarah, do you want to go ahead?
Thank you. I appreciate the update today. I'll start with what may be a tougher one. So, you know, you hear some with regards to the proof of vaccination, you know, hearing, you know, a couple restaurants in areas like Peterborough, for example, you know, are doing like eliminating dine-in as of today, not wanting to put, I guess, you know, their employees in a position of enforcing proof of vaccine. I'm wondering, have we heard anything similar here or, you know, about some struggles perhaps in the area with respect to this? Thank you.
Yeah, thanks, Sarah. I think for every public health measure, there are kind of unintended, you know, challenges with it. And certainly this will pose some challenges for some businesses and have put some businesses in, you know, in a position where they didn't feel comfortable asking their clients. For other businesses, it's done the opposite and made them more comfortable and felt that they've had the tools to be able to protect their patrons and their staff. So there's not an easy answer. I think that it's an important measure as we move into the fourth wave to prevent spread of COVID. And again, I guess repeating what the Premier said earlier today, that it's a temporary measure. I think none of us anticipate that this is going to be implemented indefinitely. This is to help us get through particularly challenging times of high risk of COVID-19 activity.
Thank you. I appreciate that. You mentioned briefly, I think, two school age cases. I'm just wondering, I think I got that right. And sort of we'll have to see, you know, in coming weeks for the full possible impact for a number of variables in the mix there. But more or less, I mean, are we with I think I heard you right with two. I mean, this is more or less what we were. Is it expected? Are we expecting? More or less, I guess, is what I'm trying to get at. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks, Sarah. And I really don't want to jinx anything by saying it's less than expected. So, I mean, one case among a high school age student, one case among an elementary school age student, neither had any spread within schools, but both resulted in a class cohort being dismissed and a bus cohort being dismissed. There's other health unit jurisdictions that have seen more school cases and actual school outbreaks. I think Windsor Essex County Health Unit has several school outbreaks right now. I think, you know, school COVID-19 activity is a reflection of community transmission in general. You know, knock on wood, our community level of transmission is somewhat stable. But as we see it increase, then I have no doubt that we'll continue to see some cases among school-age children and hopefully a very minimal number of outbreaks.
Thank you.
Great. Thanks, Sarah. So I'm actually going to turn to the chat now because Derek says his mic's not working. So I'm just going to read his question to you, Dr. Bocking. So the first one is, will people have to wait 28 days after their second COVID vaccination in order to get a flu shot?
Thanks, Derek. So the answer to that right now is yes. The recommendation is still for there to be 28 days following your COVID-19 vaccine before you receive another vaccine. The National Advisory Committee on Immunization is currently looking at whether or not we can give both the COVID-19 vaccine and influenza vaccine at the same time, but we're still waiting on their official statement, either supporting that or recommending it against it. It certainly will make things you know, a bit tricky in the fall as we approach influenza season and rolling out influenza immunization. We're anticipating that we will likely see influenza this year, given that many of the public health restrictions have been eased. And so there's more movement of people and social gatherings. Emphasizing that influenza immunization is also very important.
Okay, great. He does have a second question here. So he's one, it's again about flu. Wondering if we know if there's any conflicts with the vaccination and the COVID vaccination and the flu shot.
So I don't know if I know what you mean by conflicts, and you can always add into the chat if you have any additional specifics for that question. We know that both will continue to be rolled out and both will be available at the same time, drug interaction. So that's what NACI, or the National Advisory Committee on Immunization, is currently looking at. There doesn't seem to be, as of right now, any data or evidence that there would be a negative interaction. But again, we'll wait to see what their official statement is.
Okay, great. Thanks, Dr. Bocking, and thanks, Derek. I see Tricia Mason is on the line with us, and she has some questions. Go ahead, Tricia.
Hi, it's actually Jessica Nisnik. My computer wasn't working, so I'm pretending to be Tricia right now.
Okay, no problem, Jessica. Thanks.
Thanks. Hi, Dr. Bocking. Thanks again for the update. I have some questions about the pregnancy stuff that you were talking about. First of all, how do you know that 59% have received their vaccine? You must have to know how many pregnant women there are in HKPR.
Right. So this is actually data that was provided by the province to area health units. And the data is through an analysis through the Institute for Clinical Evaluative Sciences, or ICES. Essentially, what they're able to do is, you know, every time you go and visit a healthcare provider, you use your OHIP card, they register it in the system. And so there's really a database of all interactions with the healthcare system. And then there's certain codes that are attached to the reason why people present to care. And so pregnancy would be one of those reasons. So they're able to look at how many people are currently, you know, identified in our healthcare system to be pregnant, and then link that with records around vaccination. So it's not done at really individual level, but at kind of a bigger, what we call an aggregate level, looking at the broader database. So the numbers are certainly not perfect, but I think at least give us an indication of where things are at.
Okay, staying on pregnancy, would you happen to know, I did hear stats on pregnant women being in the ICU, but do you happen to know if they had underlying health issues, any of them?
So I don't know the answer to that question, Jessica. And I don't know what reports have been put out already by British Columbia and Alberta regarding kind of their experiences most recently. I think some of it is still preliminary as the fourth wave is starting to hit those jurisdictions with more force. But I know that it has been flagged as a concern. You know, similar to what we see with other viruses like influenza, we know can sometimes have a more significant impact on women that are pregnant compared to the general population.
Okay, I have one more question related to that, but I'll jump back to the end of the line.
Okay, that's great, Jessica. Thanks, because I see Sarah has her hand up again. So we'll get to all the questions. So Sarah, if you want to go ahead.
Hi. Okay. Thank you. Sorry, Jesse. You could have kept going there. I just wanted to circle back very quickly to the outbreaks. And I know we were talking last, and you did give a quick update here today. So I know we were talking about not expecting to see that much more spread associated with either last week. And I think you confirmed just two new cases associated with the outbreak in Northumberland, and the CECC still at 18, but I'm wondering, is that still, I guess that prediction, if you will, still true, not anticipating seeing that much more spread? And I forgive me for the ramble here, I'm going to get it out and then I'll leave you alone for today. But, you know, we did see the high-risk contacts, which you also touched on, go up pretty significantly as well. And I know you talked about how those of the confirmed cases, we have more contacts with those compared. But I guess I'm wondering, are we still anticipating further spread? And if a good chunk of those high-risk contacts are potentially associated with either outbreak? So sorry for the ramble. Hopefully that makes sense. I'm known. Thank you.
No, that's all right. I'll do my best to hopefully answer your question, Sarah. So with both of those outbreaks, if we don't see more activity this week, both of them could be declared over by the end of this week. So I think that that's quite positive and certainly moving in the right direction. I think that, like with CECC, you know, a major difference between this outbreak and the previous outbreak was that this one really was contained to one area of the facility as opposed to facility-wide. The number of high-risk contacts associated with events has increased. Now, not every high-risk contact ends up turning into a case, and it does depend on the type of exposure. But with those two outbreaks in particular, there more recently haven't been any newer cases associated with it. But again, we leave it to that full period of time, the 14 days since, to ensure that we capture any high-risk contacts that have converted to be cases. So that was a bit of my rambling response, Sarah. So if I didn't capture your question, then let me know.
No, I appreciate that. Sorry, I didn't make it easy. We saw high-risk contacts obviously spike, and more so in Kawartha recently, and I was just trying to decipher whether there was any correlation and just a brief update on the outbreaks. You did great, as always. Thank you very much, Dr. Bocking. I appreciate it.
Great. Thanks, Sarah. So Derek, the man without a voice today, has added another question into the chat, and it's about, he's asking, can you explain what the back to school Q&A virtual information session entails on September 28th, and how did this come about?
Certainly. So thanks, Derek. So essentially, it's an online virtual information session for parents or guardians or students themselves on COVID-19, and in particular, what it means for school-age children and youth. Part of how this came about, I think with our first cases in an elementary school and in a high school, we started to hear what some of the more common questions were. So I think it's helpful now that we've had that first run experience, we're hearing what the questions are, and now we're hoping to share that information to other parents and other communities so they know a bit of what to expect should there be a case at their child's school. I know certainly as a parent myself, I also, you know, talk with neighbors and talk with family members who have questions. And I think to me, it made sense to be a bit more proactive in trying to, while we're still early in the school season, answer some of these questions with the best information we currently have.
Great. Thanks, Dr. Bocking. I see Derek is still typing, but is typing right now. But maybe in the meantime, we'll turn it over to Jessica, because Jessica has her hand up with another question. Thanks.
Thank you. Still on the pregnancy. I think you said you didn't have a lot of stats, but I do know that I did a PPH one before and they had some numbers based on premature pregnancies and things like that. Do you have any other stats or anything you can share about pregnancy and COVID?
You know what, Jessica, I don't have them off the tips of my fingers or in front of me written on a paper, but I can commit to going back and seeing what we do have. I think there's some in general statistics that we could help share, whether it's through the Society of Obstetricians and Gynecologists of Canada, just kind of general ones on the impact of either COVID-19 infection on pregnancy or COVID-19 immunization. We don't have any specific statistics to HKPR jurisdiction other than the broad statistics that were shared by the province to us. At this point in time, we don't have any other detailed statistics for our region specifically.
Okay, thanks. I'd be happy just to have whatever stats you have to throw them in. So I believe Chandra has my email. If she's able to shoot me a quick email, if you have those, that information, I'd love to run it for my story for tonight. So I'd need it by like in an hour or so. I know it's not a lot of time, but if you have it, I'd appreciate it. And that's it for me. Thanks, Dr. Bocking.
Thanks, Jessica. We'll see what we can do. I think there's also a publication by Public Health Ontario. I believe I remember seeing something there, as well as, sorry, the Ontario Science Advisory Table. If you go to their website, they also have a brief on pregnancy.
Okay, thank you. I'll look there.
That's great. Good. Thanks. Thanks, Jessica, and thanks, Dr. Bocking. Derek has his another question added into the chat. Last question, I promise. Are you seeing a large amount of people going for vaccinations reluctantly due to job requirements in the HKPR?
Thanks, Derek. So we are seeing some people attend our clinics that have been reluctant to get vaccinated and do still have some concerns. And we always try and speak with them to address their concerns or any questions. Large is kind of a relative term. I mean, we know that there's only about 20% of the population that is not vaccinated. And the folks that are coming now aren't a large proportion of the population. So there's certainly, I would say, a handful, but that's not the predominant group that is showing up at the clinics.
Okay, that's great. I see Derek's typing. I'm not sure. Okay, he just says, okay, thank you. Dan has his hand up. Dan, would you want to go ahead?
Yeah, just going off that last question, in regards to the vaccine certificate requirements, I guess, with the vaccination still only going up by marginal percentage so far, just are there further measures you think that at the province should take to encourage vaccination?
Yeah, it's challenging because it's always a balance of understanding that public health measures might be affecting individual rights. So we're asking people to do something for the collective good, for broader community, with the specific objective of public health. So if we don't see a lot of COVID-19 activity, I don't anticipate that we'll see more measures. We've certainly heard that, one of the hopes behind the vaccine, kind of proof of vaccination for these settings is to avoid a lockdown, that if we can keep numbers low, encourage people to continue to be vaccinated, that we won't see other public health measures. I know there has been ongoing discussion at a provincial level around requirements for other occupations. So we have seen mandates related to very specifically to healthcare workers. I think that we could see additional occupations with provincial direction to have mandatory vaccination policies in those workplaces, whether it be enforcement, whether it be other regulated health professionals. I think hopefully we'll be learning more about that in the next week or so. And then the other area that I think there's been a lot of provincial discussion is for school-age children. We have legislation currently for other vaccinations, but the provincial government to date has not indicated that they'll be pursuing having COVID-19 vaccination either added to that legislation or be enforced in another way. So I think those two areas, we might still see some movement and activity. Again, always with the caveat, I think it depends on what's happening in terms of virus activity.
Okay, thanks.
Great, thanks, Dan. I see Sarah has her hand up again. Sarah, do you want to go ahead?
Thank you. Sorry. And I may have missed it, Dr. Buck. So I apologize. I know some weeks were able to, I think last week we had about 28,700 residents still eligible in HKPR. I didn't know if we had an up-to-date number. Thank you.
So it depends on how good you are at math. I think we're at around 26,500. I know that approximately 1,100 individuals, close, almost 1,200, received their first dose of vaccine over the last week. So we can subtract that from the number I shared last week. But I can share that with you. I'll just have to go back and look at the numbers again.
That's okay. I can have a quick look there too. I hadn't looked here earlier. I just wasn't sure if I missed it. And I apologize. I feel like I'm my worst rambler this week. Thank you, elections, than normal. So I apologize. That's it. Thank you.
Okay, great. Thanks, Sarah. So I'm just looking to see if there's any additional hands, and I don't see anything. I don't see anything in the chat. So I'm thinking that we might be finished. It looks like there's nothing else. So I think we will probably wrap up today's event. Lots of good questions, lots of good dialogue, lots of good information from Dr. Bocking. And I'd like to thank everybody for participating. And, hope everybody has a good rest of the first day of fall. And we will see you next week. Thanks, everybody. Bye-bye. Thank you.